This here is a picture of the original lighthouse that stood before the current St. Augustine Lighthouse. This one was made from coquina, but it was built too close to the water, and eventually the land underneath it was washed away and it crumbled to the ground. And here are the ruins that were left over from that crumbling lighthouse. This is a historic picture of the St. Augustine Lighthouse, and this is how it looks today. This one was completed in 1874, and it is St. Augustine's first and oldest brick structure that is still standing. It was designed by Paul J. Peltz. He also designed the Library of Congress in Washington. The lighthouse rises to 165 feet above sea level. What we're showing you here are all the displays that are in the base of the lighthouse. There's a lot of interesting artifacts that they've saved over from all the years. It was while we were in this room that we had a haunting experience that we'll share later on in the video. This container here is what they would use to put the oil inside in order to burn to keep the lens going. The lighthouse keepers would have to carry this all the way to the top of the lighthouse, and it was not light. This is the original First Order Fresnel lens. It's hand-blown. It stood 9 feet tall, and it came from Paris, France. This lens was damaged in the 1980s by a vandal who was taking a pot shot with a rifle, so you could see what it did here. There are 219 steps to reach the top of this lighthouse. There's also a very famous picture of what looks like a shadow figure up in the lighthouse stairwell looking down towards the bottom, and it is creepy as heck. Here we have the lighthouse keeper's house. The first family to live in the house was the Harn family. William Harn was originally from Philadelphia. He'd served during the Civil War as a captain of the 3rd New York Independent Battery. He fought in the battles at Fredericksburg and Gettysburg. Harn served here as head keeper for 20 years. When you visit the St. Augustine Lighthouse, there's a little cottage that you go into first, and that's where you buy your tickets. They also have a gift store in there. This was built by one of the keepers who was unwilling to live in the keeper's house because of all of the unexplained activity going on in there. One of the reasons why we have some ghost activity going on here goes back to its construction. In 1873, Hezekiah Pitty was working on the lighthouse here. When he came, he brought his four children, Eliza, who was 15, Mary, who was 12, Carrie, who was 4, and Edward, who was 8. Now, Pitty's construction workers needed a way to bring supplies up to where the lighthouse was from down by the water. And the best way to do this was to use a handcart. So they built some rails and put a handcart on it to bring supplies back and forth. There was about 200 yards of rail. Well, you can imagine the kids thought, wow, that looks like a little bit of fun. It's kind of like a roller coaster. You got a cart on rails here. So that's what they would do. They would jump inside of it, and they would ride it to the end. It would come to a stop, and then they would pull it back up the hill so they could ride back down again. Well, unfortunately, on July 10th in 1873, the Pitty kids were riding in that along with a 10-year-old female friend. And they ride it down to the gate, and unfortunately, it did not stop. It flipped over and went into the water and pinned all the kids underneath. One of the construction workers saw this happen, and he ran down, and he was able to rescue Carrie and Edward, but he couldn't save the other three children that were in there. They drowned. Now, Pitty, even though he'd lost two of his children, stayed and finished the construction. And then he eventually moved on with the rest of his family. But two of those members of his family are still here in the lighthouse. And of all the places that we have visited, this is the only place that I will say definitively is haunted. Every time we've been in this lighthouse at night, we've had an experience. We believe that experience has been interacting with two of the Pitty's children. People claim to hear the children laughing. They've seen their full-bodied apparitions, both inside the lighthouse and inside of the house. Pictures have been taken of a figure, whether it's a woman in white or who knows what, out in the woods. Another ghost that might be here is Joseph. He was painting the outside of the lighthouse, and he was doing it in this way that he kind of rigged himself up there, and he fell to his death. Apparently, he hit many things on the way down, and his family witnessed this happen. A lot of people believe that his ghost hangs out on the first floor. Down here in the basement, there's a rumor that a keeper named Pete, his ghost, is still here. He liked to come down here and sneak a smoke so that his wife wouldn't know. So you will smell the sweet smell of tobacco down here sometimes. You will feel him touch you. He likes to touch ladies, especially on their legs. He'll put pressure on men's chests. And when we were there, we think we picked up an EVP of Pete talking. He's also believed to control EMF meters, so when people tell him to touch them, he'll touch them and set them off, that kind of thing. So we did the Dark of the Moon ghost tour that they do at the St. Augustine Lighthouse. We highly recommend it. It is a lot of fun, very informative, and we always seem to have some kind of activity while we're on it. We've told the story before on the show, but just as a recap, myself and one of our listeners, Julie, were looking at the displays that are in the base of the lighthouse in the inside. It was at night, so it was kind of dark. We had to use a flashlight to see. Denise had been standing with us, and she decided she wanted to go back up the stairs, but she wasn't sure if we could do that, so she wanted to go out and ask the tour guide if it was okay for her to go back up the stairs to the top of the lighthouse. It was shortly after she left that we started hearing a pounding on the outer door to the lighthouse. Julie and I kind of looked at each other and were like, the door should be unlocked and open. It's been that way the whole time. So after a while, we decided to go investigate when the pounding continued. We saw that the door was closed, so we tried to open it from our side, and we could not get it to budge. I looked up and I saw this little, it looked like a little turn screw thing that might have been a type of lock, but it was very small. It wasn't like a deadbolt lock. And it was kind of hanging away from the door, so I thought it was broken. So I thought, well, maybe we got locked in on accident and this thing broke. We had another listener with us named Jaron, who was a big guy, and we asked him if he could get the door open, and he couldn't. We could hear Denise on the other side trying to get it open, and she got my dad to come over, and he couldn't get it open from his end. So finally, a tour guide came over. He stuck his key in what was the real deadbolt and unlocked the door, and we were able to open the door at that time. And when we asked him about the part of the door that seemed to be hanging free, I said, is this broken? And he goes, oh, that thing hasn't worked for a long time. That's not really even part of the door anymore. He said, the only thing that locks this door is this deadbolt. And the only person who has a key to that deadbolt is me. So the only way that that deadbolt could have locked itself was if he had come over and locked it. And he hadn't, because Denise was going over to him to ask if she could go up the stairs. So who locked us into the lighthouse? We think it was Eliza. So it's possible that we have at least four ghosts here, maybe five if you count the figure in white out in the woods. Are there really ghosts here at the lighthouse? Is it haunted? Well, that is for you to decide, but we're pretty positive that it is.